Thank you for your participation in Washington Sea Grant's Crab Team Volunteer Monitoring Program. It is with your help that we will improve our understanding of native salt marsh and pocket estuary organisms here in Washington State and have the best chance of finding invasive European green crab while they can still be controlled. In this video, we'll go through the Crab Team protocol step by step as a refresher for existing volunteers or a primer for those new to or interested in the program. There is nothing worse than traveling to your site and realizing that you are missing a crucial piece of gear. We suggest using the checklist in your volunteer handbook as a guide to pack everything in your car ahead of time. Equipment includes your device for taking digital photographs, your copy of the permit that allows you to possess a European green crab, 3 rectangular Fukui traps, 3 steel minnow traps, 3 pre-portioned frozen mackerel and 6 bait jars, 6 pencil rod trap stakes, 1 set of calipers, laminated photo ID cards for photographing the collection bins, and wax pencils to write on them. You can fill these out before you go to the site, which is easier than writing on them once they are wet. Two sorting bins, one with a scale bar and one without. A PVC quadrat. A marked 50 meter rope or transect tape. Gloves to protect your hands. The laminated ID guide. A pencil for the waterproof paper. A clipboard. Waterproof data sheets, both for trapping data and the shoreline survey data. A hand lens for the fine detail observation when identifying species. Be sure to check all 6 traps to ensure that they are in good condition and free of debris before heading to your site. Before you leave your site, take the bait out early enough that it will thaw a bit before being put into the traps. This will help you attract more crabs. If you get to your site and the bait is still as hard as a rock, you can set the bag in a tub full of seawater to help loosen it up. Be sure that each trap is still labeled with its orange tag and contact information for Washington Sea Grant. Each month between April and September, Crab Team volunteers set 6 baited traps, 3 minnow and 3 fukui, near the shoreline for 1 nighttime high tide. This approach targets shore crabs when they are the most active. Crab Team staff will provide you with calendars that suggest the best days for trapping specific to each region. The goal is to maximize the time that the traps are actively fishing in the water, but also ensure that no organisms in the traps will be stranded out of the water or immersed in completely fresh water as the tide recedes. At lagoon or channel sites that retain water even on the lowest tides, traps are submerged just beyond the water's edge after low tide and retrieved on the falling tide the next day. At tide flat or high elevation sites, the traps must be set when the tide is coming back in from a lower low tide at a depth deeper than the higher low tide and retrieved the next day as the tide is receding and before the traps are exposed. Every site is different, and Crab Team staff can help you discuss the particulars of your site. It's easiest to load the bait into the bait jars while you are still on the beach. Empty the contents of one pre-portioned bait bag to each jar and put one jar in each trap. The clasp mechanisms on the metal minnow traps can be a little tricky to manipulate at first. We suggest practicing at home a few times before taking them out to the field. You will first want to interlock the double hook and clasp on the back of the trap. Then turn over the trap and line up the two metal eyelets side by side. Pinch together the two arms on the metal pin and loop the now exposed hook through both eyelets and unpinch the arms to secure the pin. Double check that the orange tag is still attached to each trap. The Fukui traps are a bit easier to secure. Simply fold the top together and secure the plastic clips. We suggest starting with the middle clip and then moving on to the two side clips. There is no need to further secure the bait jars inside the traps. We will now set the traps up parallel to the shore in a string of traps spaced 10 meters apart from one another. Each trap should be set in about the same depth of water as the others, and the type of trap should alternate. Minnow, Fukui, Minnow, Fukui. The string of alternating traps should always be placed in the same spot and direction down the beach at your site. However, it is not important which trap type is first, and this can even change each month, as long as the trap types alternate. The first trap will be aligned to your semi-permanent orange-capped site marker. Set the trap at a depth so that it is at least partially submerged and will remain at least half submerged until you return to collect the traps. This elevation on the shore will vary from site to site, but the crab team will help you determine this. Be sure the orange tag is on top of your minnow traps and insert the metal pencil rod all the way through the trap. The bent portion of the stake should be level with the top of the trap, pinning it securely in place. Each trap should be spaced about 10 meters apart. To measure this, you can simply start at the previous trap and take 10 relatively large strides down the beach. This will be about 10 meters. You can also measure using your site's 50-meter rope, but the markings can be difficult to see from the water, and often the transect line is curvy, meaning traps end up closer than 10 meters. Feel free to use whichever method you feel can repeat the most consistently and that you feel the most comfortable with. If the substrate is too hard to get the pencil rod through, change the angle of the stake or move the trap a little up and down the shore parallel to the beach in order to find a spot where you can be sure the trap will stay securely in place with the stake all the way through. If this is an ongoing challenge at your site, check with Crab Team staff. Shortening the stakes might be appropriate, or weighting the traps. Once all six traps are staked into place, record the date and time that the last trap was set on the upper right corner of your trapping data sheet. It is important to have this time accurately recorded so that we know the exact time that the traps were actively fishing. We find that using a pencil works best for waterproof paper, as ink has difficulty when the paper is wet. That is all you will need to do with the traps on the first day. The following day, you will return to retrieve the traps as the water is receding again towards a lower low tide. Another goal of the Crab Team project is to get some background, big picture information about pocket estuary habitats that house crustaceans in the Puget Sound. We are interested in the quality of these habitats, how it's associated with green crabs and the other organisms that live there, and how it changes over time. To get information about a shoreline habitat, you will conduct a transect survey of your site once a month. This can be done on either the first day of sampling, when you set the traps, or the second day when you retrieve them. Some people find it easier to do the first day of sampling because setting the traps takes less time than retrieval. But whatever is more convenient for you is just fine. For this survey, you will be setting a 50-meter rope or transect tape along the lower edge of the terrestrial vegetation or riprap, depending on your site, where it meets the subtidal zone of mud, sand, or aquatic plants. Here, you will take measurements of what types of animals, vegetation, and substrate are found at 10 points along the rope or tape using your PVC quadrat frame. Start at your site marker. Here, you will see that we have identified where the site marker is, but since it is further up the shore, we secured the 50-meter rope with a rock parallel to the marker. To find your habitat boundary line, identify where the bare ground of the subtidal zone meets the terrestrial environment. At the site pictured here, we laid our rope following where the mud and sand meet the pickleweed plants. Pickleweed is common, but your site may also have marsh grass or riprap. The crab team will help you with identifying this boundary. The boundary of the terrestrial environment will weave along the beach. Be careful to follow this contour with your rope or tape. You can connect gaps that will take you more than 5 meters to connect. After you've traced the tidal boundary for 50 meters, you will be collecting information on this zone at random intervals with your 0.1 square meter quadrat. The quadrat sampling locations are chosen by randomly generated numbers given to you at the beginning of the trapping season by the crab team. Each month, you will be using a new set of distances along your 50-meter transect at which to take your observations. At each of the randomly generated distances for that month, you will place your quadrat on the landward, meaning away from the water, and on the positive side of the meter mark you are measuring, meaning towards the higher values. Because you will be gathering data based on the area landward of your transect rope, when possible, it is good practice to walk along the side closer to the water. This will prevent you from damaging any of the animals or vegetation on which you are attempting to gather data. In each quadrat, you will take observations like an archaeologist, starting with the top layer and digging down in three steps. Step 1, rack. Step 2, cover. Step 3, substrate. The first thing you will be recording data on at each quadrat location is the amount and types of rack within the square. Rack is anything that has washed up or is not rooted on the shore. This includes eelgrass, seaweed, dislodged terrestrial vegetation like woody debris and leaves, and trash. Anything, even biodegradable or organic materials that has been littered by humans. We are only estimating the top layer of rack, what you would see if you were taking a picture from above. In step 1, only record vegetation that is dislodged from the shore. Rooted vegetation will be recorded in the next step. The quadrats are divided into 4 smaller squares, each 25% of the total quadrat. Use these divisions as a guide for helping you estimate the amount of cover for each category to the nearest 5%. A little less than half of one subsection would be about 10% coverage. Slightly more than 2 squares would be about 60% coverage. Confer with your other team members to reach a consensus about the value of each estimate. Round all estimates to the nearest 5%. But if a category isn't present in at least approximately 5%, you don't need to record it. It's possible that your quadrat is on an area without rack present. In this case, it's okay to write 0% for each category. Even though a pile of rack can often consist of many interwoven layers, the total of 4 categories of rack should not exceed 100% cover of that quadrat, because we are only assessing the top layer. If you find molts in your quadrat, you can set them aside and might want to remember they're there for the molt hunt, but they are not counted as rack. After you have estimated the rack, remove all of it from your quadrat in order to move on to step 2, ground cover. This step includes live epifauna, usually barnacles or mussels, live rooted vegetation, and bare ground. This includes rocks and dead organisms. When the values of these categories are added together, they should always total 100% to account for all of the space in the quadrat. Use the same technique for area estimation that you used for the rack, utilizing the smaller squares to estimate cover to the nearest 5%. For rooted vegetation, lift the plants slightly to get a better idea of how much is attached to the substrate. We are interested in knowing how much vegetation is rooted to the shore and less interested in how much is covered in the comb-over of greenery from leggy plants. For live epifauna, we are counting the space occupied by any live animal that can't walk out of the quadrat faster than you can record it. Typically, these are barnacles and mussels, but you might also see snails or limpets. Crabs do not get counted here. To distinguish living from dead barnacles, note that outer shells that appear empty are dead. If you can see small plates covering the opening, called opercular plates of the barnacle, it is alive. Live mussels are typically closed or responsive to touch. If a mussel is gaping or unresponsive, it is likely dead. Check snail shells to see if they are occupied by living snails by looking for a small plate covering the opening. Count dead epifauna or snail shells occupied by hermit crabs as bare ground. Filamentous green algae is a type of aquatic plant found mostly in shallow water that is made up of thin strands which are matted together, forming sheets that appear like wet green wool. It's most often present in the early spring. Sometimes it's hard to tell if it's attached to the substrate or has washed in. If it's sitting on the mud, we are considering it to be growing on the site and should be categorized here. If it's draped on top of the rooted vegetation, it should be categorized as wrack. The final step for each quadrat, step 3, is to record the dominant type of substrate within your quadrat. There may be more than one type present, but circle only one on your data sheet that you feel represents the most coverage. To tell the difference between mud and sand, which is sometimes difficult when they are damp, we suggest poking and squeezing a bit of the substrate. Mud will be more malleable when poked and can be shaped into clumps when squeezed. Sand will not hold together when squeezed. In order to tell the difference between gravel and cobble, we consider anything larger than what you would use to pave your driveway to be cobble, or anything larger than a softball. Fill out every step for all 10 randomly determined sites, including the distance in the upper right-hand corner. Your next task will be to search for crab molts. Often, the first time a green crab is detected in a new area, it is a molted shell rather than a live crab. You are also likely to see molts for species that are present in the habitat but which might not be attracted to the traps, such as the hairy helmet crab. The goal of the molt search is to collect as many molts as possible in a total of 20 volunteer minutes. This means that one team member would search for 20 minutes, two members would search for 10 minutes each, four members would search for 5 minutes, and so on. While the timer is running, don't worry about identifying the species of molt that you are collecting. Simply place them one at a time in your collection container and continue searching. Counting and identifying will happen afterwards. Always begin as a group at your site marker. Start a timer, but then feel free to target areas that you believe will have the most molts in either direction of your site marker. Often, this will be in rack deposits, under piles of woody debris, or at the base of rooted vegetation. If you do come across an area with many molts piled together, please place each molt one at a time into your collection container. Avoid scooping multiple molts at a time, as this could easily damage the fragile shells, making them difficult to identify. This is also a way we put a limit on the total number of molts that you will have to sort through afterwards. Collect any crustacean shell you find, including shrimp and amphipod shells. While our eyes are often drawn to large molts, like those of Dungeness crab, most molts will actually be quite small. So don't be shy about taking a close look, sifting through the wrack or down between the stems of vegetation. Don't worry about identifying them while you are in the collection phase, but it is worth noting that you might come across some dead crabs as opposed to crab molts. Molts can be distinguished from dead crabs in several ways. Crabs molt along a smooth line on the side or underside of their carapace, crawling backwards out of their shell. If you can open the shell like a jewelry box, with the hinges near the eyes, that's a good sign it's a molt. Crabs also molt the tissue that covers their gills, so you might see what looks like gills inside a molted shell. However, that should be the only remaining tissue. If the shell is heavy, filled with gray or orange goo, and has a strong odor, it is likely a dead crab. The shells of dead crabs are often darker gray, as opposed to the more bleached, matte, textured shells of molts. Collect the dead crabs during your molt hunt as well, but they will be recorded separately. Stop immediately when your group's timer goes off and combine all individual collection bins into one. Because molts can be taken from the beach, this step can be done in a comfortable place, like a nearby picnic table or even at your home. At this time, you will begin sorting out molts from dead crabs or incomplete molts, identifying countable molts using your Crab Team ID guide. This guide will be very important as you record your data on the Molt Hunt data sheet, located on the back of the transect data sheet. Remember the mnemonic for crab identification? Clever crabs will conquer, or carapace, claws, walking legs, and color. In many cases, you will have only a bleached carapace, so use a hand lens to get a good look at the features of the shell. Go through identification using these steps and record your species using the species codes also found in your guide. Only count molts where 50% or more of the carapace are present. This will allow proper identification and prevent you from counting multiple parts of a single molt as more than one crab, therefore overestimating the number of crabs at your site. Every species will receive its own row on the data sheet, and you can simply tally up the crabs as you go. There is no need at this time to measure or sex the crabs. If you discover that you have collected any dead crabs in your molt search, record how many you found in the notes section for each species, but do not include dead crabs in the overall tally. If you find a molt that has 50% or more of the carapace, but you can't identify the species, take a few photographs and make a placeholder in your data sheet labeled Unknown A or UNKA, followed by an Unknown B, C, etc. if there are others you can't identify. Send the photos and a description to the crab team and update the placeholder in your data sheet before submitting. You can hang on to the molt in case we can't identify it from the photo and need to retrieve the specimen. If you find a green crab molt, photograph and keep the molt and contact the crab team immediately. To avoid recounting the same molts the next time you visit your site, crush them on the shore after you have finished recording your data. After an overnight soak, you will return the second day while the tide is ebbing to retrieve your traps. Fill your two white bins with an inch or two of water and empty the contents of one trap at a time into the bin with the scale bars. Record the time that the trap first was removed from the water and the predominant weather condition that the traps experienced while they were set. Here, we are starting with the minnow trap. Remove the stake and shake off as much debris from the trap as possible. It's good practice to place the pencil rods upright into the ground because they are very easy to lose if they are laid down on the ground. Have one person sift through the contents and handle the measurements, and another person record the data. Fill out the laminated photo ID card labeled Minnow 1 with the site number, the site name, and the date and place into the bin with the organisms. It's easier to do this step at home, before the card has the possibility of getting wet. The order in which you collect the traps is not important, as long as the trap number on the photo ID card matches the trap information on the data sheet. Photograph the entire bin, trying your best to capture as many organisms as possible, and avoiding glare and shadows. But this will not be possible if the trap has several layers of crabs. You might want to take several photos, as sometimes If it is bright outside, it is difficult to see whether the photo was in focus on the screen. If the trap is empty, still fill out the photo ID card. Photograph it in an empty bin and write empty into the data sheets with the species section. We then begin to identify each species in the trap and count their total number. Your hand lens can be useful at this time to see finer detail like hairs on walking legs. Count and release fish first, as they are the most sensitive. For each variety of fish, shrimp, or snail, the only information you need to record is the total number of that variety. For crabs, like the hairy shore crabs seen here, you will record the sex and measure to the nearest millimeter up to 10 males and 10 females. After you have measured 10 from each sex, continue to tally every member present of that species. Hermit crabs are treated like fish, with only a total recorded. No information on size or sex is needed. Always move the organism into the second bucket without the scale bar after you have recorded your data in order to avoid double counting or losing a data point before you are ready. Remember to release fish before starting to count the crabs. Again, measure and sex up to 20 crabs from each species. After you have reached that number, tally the remaining number of male and female crabs separately so that you can record a total number of male and total number of female crabs for each species. The sex of the crab is determined by looking at the crab's abdomen on their undersides. Typically, the abdomen is wider on females than males. In males, there is an additional plate visible between the abdomen and the legs. You may occasionally encounter an individual like this. This is a male that has been infected with a parasite, making it look more like a female. You can see here that the abdomen is wider than typical for a male, but it does not quite extend to the legs like a female. In a situation like this, this individual would be counted as a male. But please make a note in the comments section about how many of your males were feminized. If you find hermit crabs, like these hairy hermit crabs, you do not need to measure or sex them. Simply record the total individuals for that species present, just as you would for fish or shrimp, like these four sand shrimp and single broken back shrimp. After every individual is accounted for in the minnow 1, or M1 as your data sheet will say, you may release the organisms gently into the water and collect and record the rest of the traps in the same manner. Pay special attention when emptying the fukui traps. Crabs love to hide in the corners of these and cling to the fine mesh. Be sure you double check to ensure you've gotten everything out. It helps to have a spotter to make sure there are no escapees during the trap emptying. This trap will be labeled fukui 1. Then it's a matter of following the same steps as before. Place the photo ID card, photograph the bin, record and release fish, record the size and sex of the crabs, and count all other species members. If you come across an organism you can't identify, take several photographs from different angles and with something in the photo for a scale reference. You may mark it on your data sheet in a similar fashion as the crab molt data. Unknown species A. UNKA. But be sure to change this when you hear back from the crab team and before you submit your data sheets. If you are certain that the organism is not a green crab, release it along with the others into the tide. If you are not certain, treat it as if it were a green crab, contacting the crab team immediately with photographs from the beach if possible. Keep the crab live until we can confirm the ID, and we will try to get the crab from you as soon as possible. The best way to do this is to place the crab in a bucket or cooler with some paper towels or newspaper soaked in salt water and set it in a cool, shady place under a tree or in your garage. Cleaning the gear will not only prolong its use, but also reduce the chance we could accidentally transport organisms with it. To reduce our impact on these low-energy sites, take the bait home with you to dispose of. Remove any large debris by hand from the traps, like seaweed. Rinse the traps thoroughly in the water at the site to remove mud and finer debris. Cleaning as much as possible at the site will make cleaning easier at home. and will also reduce the risk that you are transporting organisms that may be on the traps to a different location. To prolong the life of the equipment, rinse everything in fresh water when you return home. Most teams will only be using gear at a single site, but if you are using the same traps at multiple locations, additional cleaning steps are required. The crab team will provide you with further instructions if this is the case. Small holes in the mesh can be repaired using zip ties. This is also a good time to make sure that the orange tag with Washington Sea Grant's contact information is attached to each trap. If you need more trap tags, notify Washington Sea Grant as soon as possible so we can mail you new ones. Store the equipment in a dry, covered space out of direct sunlight until their next use. Submit all your data sheets and crab trap photos via email within a week of retrieving your traps. You can either scan or take separate photographs of all of your complete data sheets. You will be submitting a total of at least 9 photos, one of each of the collection bins, including the empty ones, one of the trapping data sheet, one of the transect data sheet, and one of the molt hunt data sheet. If you had to go onto the back of your trapping data sheet, be sure to submit that as well. Check that the photos are of high enough resolution to read the writing on a computer screen before sending them. Sometimes phones will offer you the choice of sending a small file size, but this is often too low resolution to read. Rename each of the images of the trap collection buckets with your site number, the year, just the last two numerals, the month, the trap type, and the trap number, all separated by periods. Rename each of the data sheets similarly, but with the site number, the year, the month, the type of data sheet it is, and a 1 if it is the front, a 2 if it was the back of the sheet. Please retain all the hard copies of the data sheets. At the end of the season, you will mail all the original data sheets from the entire season to the crab team using the envelope you received at the beginning. Thank you for taking the time to watch this video. By keeping your eyes on the beach and your boots in the mud, you play a vital role in helping Washington Sea Grant's crab team monitor for the European green crab and increase understanding of the pocket estuaries and salt marshes of the Puget Sound region.
I was filming that.
Were you?
No, she was outside.
We're all messed up.